Can I first of all thank Operation Blackvolt and United Friends and Family Campaign, all the supporting organisations, Campaign for Justice, Black Mental Health, INQUEST, who have supported and helped us get this together at very short notice. The point of the press conferences today is to say that in order that justice is done, and seem to be done here in the United Kingdom, and we avoid the kind of civil disturbances that we saw in August at the shooting of Mark Dunn, it is absolutely critical that we have a full, open, public and transparent judicial inquiry into deaths in custody. We want to reform the inquest system and IPCC and lots of other areas, and we want to make sure that no other family has to go through the sheer nightmare and terror and prolonged agony, and it is prolonged agony even after death. We saw that with Christopher Adler most recently, but you equally hear it from these families. The prolonged agony of continual denial of justice that faces them in their struggle some sort of reconciliation and closure on the death of their loved one.
We know some of the high profile deaths because of their shocking circumstances and the fantastic family-led campaigns for justice. But we mustn't forget the hundreds of other deaths that take place behind the closed walls of our institutions that raise serious concerns about the treatment of some of society's most vulnerable people. And I think it's important to say that clearly deaths in custody are a human rights issue, because what we're talking about is the discrimination, the inhuman and degrading treatment that are meted out to men, women and children. And of course, it's also a human rights issue because of the right to life and the fact that the deaths expose our failure to protect the right to life, but also some appalling deaths that result from the state taking the life of others.
Half of those who die in police custody are mental health service users. Their data also shows that 20% of people who die in police custody are black men. Our concern is a pathways into care when people enter the system. Mental health care is the only area of health care where you can be detained and treated against your will. Black people are uniformly detained against their will under Section 136 of the Mental Health Act. Pathways into care are via police cells. A police cell is considered to be a place of safety. So the reason we're speaking out against this is, unless we see a joined up approach, I don't see how else the use of things like a police cell as a place of safety that criminalises somebody that's vulnerable, and we know in many cases results in deaths, is going to be addressed. I also wanted to mention cases that have come to our attention and the reason why we actually exist. Like the work the inquest does brought to our attention the case of David Bennett. David Bennett is considered to be the Stephen Lawrence of the mental health world. He was restrained by a team of nurses for almost half an hour. They released him once they realised he stopped breathing. No attempt was made to resuscitate him. And Inquest was doing work with his sister, Dr. Joanna Bennett, and that's how it came to our attention, and that's why Black Mental Health UK was launched. It was because of David Bennett. One thing that we won't really see on the radar nationally unless we have a public inquiry is the fact that it's people who use mental health services that are dying in largest numbers. Of all deaths in custody, 61%, according to the latest statistics, of people who die in the care of the state are mental health service users. And so I welcome this meeting, and I'm really hoping that our issue will be one of the key ones on the agenda.
We recently had the riots earlier on this summer, which really was an expression of the youth and society's contempt for leadership. And as a consequence of those riots, many of those that were found to be a breach in crime were fast-tracked into the court system and basically were sentenced very quickly, often in a day or two, to 6 months, I think was the standard protocol sentence. But look at families like ours who have lost loved ones in police custody under suspicious circumstances, and many of us, not months, not days, years after, are still fighting for even just a court case to be heard. This is a travesty. This is hypocrisy. And this is something that we, as a community, as a society, need to come together to fight against as a collective.
We definitely need to have a public inquiry into deaths in custody to show the systematic failures, and there's actually a pattern. Because now the years have gone by and the deaths, there's actually a pattern that I believe that we can show and prove that deaths in custody need to stop now.
If we felt that we were in safe hands, you know, with the system that's supposed to investigate a death in custody when somebody is vulnerable and they haven't been offered the correct duty of care and they've been completely failed, you would think as a, you know, as a citizen of a fairly decent country, that you would be in safe hands and you could leave it up to officials to do their job. But no, you know, we've learned that you just simply cannot leave it up to them. And I back everything that everybody has said today because it needs to be scrutinised, because the government think that they have certain procedures in place. You know, I don't know what planet they're on, because on the ground, in reality, it's a complete sham and it really doesn't work. And we had to watch CCTV of my brother die at the feet of officers while they stood around and did nothing, you know. And then they then tried to cover up their tracks after that. And these are the kind of things that day to day we have to go through. We've got a mother who has had to bury her son. You know, it's just, it's really excruciatingly painful.
It's horrific for what the family has to go through, the community, everybody who knows King's a direct, to know that he was detained under the Mental Health Act, Section 2 of the Mental Health Act. And basically, first of all, he was detained under the 136, as Matilda was saying, after calling 999 for help. How can you call 999 for help and end up dead 3 days later? Obviously, it's bewildering. But in terms of the public inquiry, if we don't have public inquiries, families like ourselves are going to continue to bereave in pain. It's going to continue to happen. It's just like a mirror image. What was happening in the 60s is exactly to what's happening now. But if we don't have the public inquiry, we'll never have the end to deaths in custody.
There is a belief on the streets that there is an element of the police that literally have a license to kill people. And that they will never be prosecuted, they will never be brought to justice, they have a license, they have the green light to kill who they will at their discretion. And because that belief is there, then behaviors emanate from that. When incidents like what happened with Mark Duggan, where he was shot dead by police in Tottenham, and a very peaceful attempt to get answers from the police was met with contempt, with flagrant disregard. This erupted into the riots that we saw sweep across the nation. Now, as a pastor, I worked with the Duggan family and can say that they have sent their apologies and would have liked to have been here today. But walking with them through that process was very, very painful for me to see a family grieving at the sudden loss of a loved one and unable to get very simple answers to very simple questions. It is inflammatory, it inflamed the community, it was at the heart of the riots, and if it is allowed to continue, we will see more and more disturbances of that nature.
I want to say to the families that I feel a sense of your pain, your shared pain, which we endure every place I land, we're facing this pain. And I would urge you to stand together as a family and get your next door neighbors involved in this fight. 338 people killed in police custody in 10 years, that's bigger than Abu Ghraib. And then those who have the most power must be the most accountable. We said in this country, 2 million people in Hyde Park, to Mr. Blair, Mr. Bush, don't go into Iraq. They determined that they went to the wrong target, killed thousands of people, and call it collateral damage, and spent several $1 trillion, which has bankrupted America and Britain and Europe. The euro dollar and the American dollar is in crisis today because of too few got too much, too many in poverty, and too much violence, and too many unnecessary wars. We'll challenge that for it, and not only save our relatives, but to save the country. That's a bigger challenge. The genius of Mandela was he came out of jail with a plan not for retribution, but for redemption and reconciliation. Some sense, whether it's Dr. King or Jesus or Mandela, they keep saying to us, there's a bigger plan than retribution. It's called redemption, reconciliation, reconstruction, and take the risk for the big game. Thank you very much.
Thank you.